Hello everyone, this is our next lecture on the chapter descriptive statistics and our topic is measure of dispersion. In last lecture we saw the definition of dispersion, that is dispersion is the extent to which a distribution is stretched or squeezed or observations are scattered or dispersed from the central value, and this variation is called as a dispersion. After that we saw the definitions of absolute and relative measure of dispersion. So absolute measure of dispersion are expressed in the same measuring units in which the original data are given, and relative measure of dispersion, it is the ratio of measure of absolute dispersion to the appropriate average. In today's lecture we will see next measure of dispersion, range and quartile deviation. So our first measure of dispersion is range. Range is the simple measure of dispersion and it is suitable if the extent of variation is small. So the definition of range is defined as the difference of smallest observation and the largest observation of the distribution. That is, range is equal to L minus S, where L is the largest observation and S is the smallest observation. So the definition of range is equal to L minus S, that is largest observation minus smallest observation. Range is used in number of fields where data have less variation. For example, range is useful in stock market to know the fluctuation, or in weather forecasting to know the limits within which the temperature is likely to vary on a particular day, we use the range. So the definition of range is L minus S. That means range is most commonly used measure of dispersion. We use it in our everyday life. And its definition is range is equal to L minus S. The corresponding relative measure of dispersion is known as coefficient of range. And its definition is coefficient of range is equal to L minus S upon L plus S, where L is the largest observation and S is the smallest observation. For example, 5 people play golf and one hole their score are 3, 4, 4, 5 and 7. For these scores, find range and coefficient of range. So for this example, we have to find range and coefficient of range. So the definition of range is equal to L minus S. So for this series we have to first find largest observation and smallest observation. So from this series the smallest observation is 3 and the largest observation is 7. So the given is here smallest observation S is equals to 3 and largest observation, that is L, is equal to 7. So the definition of range is equal to L minus S. Substitute the value of L and S. The value of L is 7 and the value of S is 3. So 7 minus 3, which is equals to 4. Now the second question is, we have to find coefficient of range. So the formula for coefficient of range or definition of coefficient of range is coefficient of range is equal to L minus S upon L plus S. Just substitute the value of L and S. It is 7 minus 3 divided by 7 plus 3. 7 minus 3 is 4 and 7 plus 3 is 10. So it is 4 divided by 10, which is equals to 0.4. Therefore, for this example, range is 4 and coefficient of range is 0.4. Since the data is of individual type of data, so we use the formula range is equal to L minus S and coefficient of range is equal to L minus S upon L plus S. Now we will see the another example. The following data gives weights of 100 students in pounds. Compute range and coefficient of range. So here data is in the form, this is the continuous type of data. So for continuous type of data, we see how to find smallest observation and how to find the largest observation. So for the smallest observation, we have to consider the smallest class interval. So here smallest class interval is 85 to 95. So the smallest observation is midpoint of the smallest class interval. and we know that we can calculate midpoint by using the formula upper class limit plus lower class limit divided by 2. That is 85 plus 95 divided by 2. 85 plus 95 divided by 2, which is equals to 90. So the midpoint of this class interval is 90, and therefore the smallest observation is 90. Here S is equals to 90. Similarly, for largest observation, we have to consider the largest class interval. So the largest class interval is 175 to 185, and the midpoint of this class interval is 175 plus 185 divided by 2, that is 180. So here largest observation, which is equals to 180, and smallest observation is equal to 90. For discrete, for continuous frequency distribution, we can find the smallest observation and largest observation by taking the mid value of the largest class interval and smallest class interval. Now we know the formula for range is equal to L minus S. Just substitute the values of L and S. Here L is 180 and S is 90. So 180 minus 90, which is equals to 90. Now the second question is, we have to find the coefficient of range. The formula for coefficient of range is L minus S upon L plus S. 180 minus 90 divided by 180 plus 90. 90 divided by 270, which is equals to 0.3333. So in this way, we can calculate range for individual type of data or for continuous frequency distribution. Next topic is merits and demerits of range. So first one, what are the merits of range? Range is the simplest to understand and easiest to compute and rigidly define. Means its definition is very clear to understand and so examples are very simple to calculate. Second merit is it requires very less time to calculate. So it requires very less time to calculate. Then demerits of range. First demerit is range is not based on all observation of the data. As we saw the definition of range, it is L minus S, means we consider only two observation, that is largest observation of the series and smallest observation of the series, and remaining observations are not in the consideration. So range is not based on the all observation of the data, and this is the drawback of range. Next one is range is very much affected by fluctuation of sampling. So range is affected by the fluctuations of sampling. Next drawback is range cannot be computed for the distribution with open end classes. So we cannot calculate the range for open end classes, because for continuous type of frequency distribution, we saw for this type of data we have to calculate the midpoint of the lower class interval and midpoint of the highest class interval. So for open end classes, we cannot calculate the midpoint. So therefore, we cannot calculate range for the open end classes. And last drawback is range is not suitable for further mathematical treatment. We cannot calculate any other statistical or mathematical treatment from the range. This is the drawback of range. So these are the merits and demerits of the range. We saw the range uses only two extreme observations, that is largest observation and smallest observation. Hence, in any change in between the observation is not going to affect the range, and this is the main drawback of range. However, in many situations, extreme observations are widely separated from the remaining observation. Therefore, range fails to give the true picture of the dispersion. This is the main drawback of range. And to overcome this drawback, the next measure of dispersion is quartile deviation, or it is also known as semi-interquartile range. So the difference between the upper and lower quartile, that is Q3 and Q1. The difference of Q3 minus Q1 is known as interquartile range. This is the important question for the fill in the blanks. Q3 minus Q1 is known as interquartile range, and half of this difference is called as semi-interquartile range or quartile deviation. It is denoted by Q dot D, and its definition is quartile deviation is Q3 minus Q1 divided by 2, where Q1 is lower quartile and Q3 is upper quartile. So here important point is the difference, that is Q3 minus Q1, is known as interquartile range, and the definition of quartile deviation is Q3 minus Q1 divided by 2, where Q3 is upper quartile and Q1 is lower quartile. And the corresponding measure of dispersion used for comparison is known as the coefficient of quartile deviation, and its definition is coefficient of quartile deviation is equal to Q3 minus Q1 divided by Q3 plus Q1. So the definition of quartile deviation is Q3 minus Q1 divided by 2, and its relative measure of dispersion is coefficient of quartile deviation, and its definition is coefficient of quartile deviation is equals to Q3 minus Q1 divided by Q3 plus Q1. For example, calculate quartile deviation and coefficient of quartile deviation for the following data. So data is given. Our first step is we have to check the type of data. So here data is in the continuous type of data. So for this type of data, we have to calculate quartile deviation and coefficient of quartile deviation. As we just saw, the definition of quartile deviation is equal to quartile deviation is equal to Q3 minus Q1 divided by 2, where Q3 is upper quartile and Q1 is equal to the lower quartile. So for this type of data, we know the definition of Q3 and Q1. The formula for Q1 is equal to L plus N by 4 minus CF upon F into H. And the formula for Q3 is equal to L plus 3N by 4 minus CF upon F into H. So for this, first we have to locate our Q1 class and Q3 class. And we know that the value of Q1 class is decided from the value of N by 4. And the value of Q3 class is decided from the value of 3N by 4. So our first step is we have to decide our Q1 class and Q3 class. And for this, we have to calculate N by 4 and 3N by 4. So the same data, we will write the same data in terms of, in the form of the columns. So first row is, that is first column is marks as it is, and second column is number of student, it is also as it is. Now the third column is less than type cumulative frequency. So for less than type cumulative frequency, first observation as it is, then this 10 plus 20, that is 10 plus 20, which is equals to 30. Now this 30 plus 30, which is equal to 60. Now this 60 plus 50, which is equals to 110. Next one is 110 plus this 40. So 110 plus 40, which is equals to 150. And next 150 plus 30, which is equals to 180. So our first step is we have to calculate the less than type cumulative frequency just to locate our quartile classes, that is Q1 class and Q3 class. So for Q1 class, firstly we have to find the value of N by 4. So for this example, N capital N is equals to, or summation of Fi equals to 180. So N by 4 is equal to 180 divided by 4, which is equals to 45. Now we have to check that less than type cumulative frequency, which is just greater than 45. So 10 is less than 45, 30 is less than 45, but 60 is greater than 45, and 60 is the first value which is greater than 45. So our Q1 class is this class, 20 to 30. This is our Q1 class. because it is the first value which is just greater than the 45. So Q1 class is equal to 20 to 30, means its lower quartile is 20. Now we know the formula for Q1 is equal to L plus N by 4 minus Cf upon F into H, where L is the lower limit of the Q1 class, Cf is the cumulative frequency just preceding to that class, F is the frequency of that class, and H is the class width. So for our quartile class is 20 to 30 and its lower limit is 20. So just substitute the value of L, that is equal to 20. N by 4, as we calculated, it is 45. So substitute the value of N by 4, 45 minus Cf. Cf means cumulative frequency of the preceding class, the class just above the Q1 class. Cumulative frequency of this preceding to this class, that is 30. 30 is the cumulative frequency preceding to that Q1 class. F is the frequency of that class, means frequency of this class is Q1, which is equals to 30. So just substitute the value of F is 30, and H is the class width. Class width is equal to upper class limit minus lower class limit, that is 30 minus 20, which is equals to 10. Now after doing all this calculation, the value of Q1 is equal to 25, and you can check your answer is right or wrong, whether the answer lies in that class interval. So our class interval is 20 to 30 and the value 25 lies between 20 to 30. So our answer is right. Now we have to calculate Q3, because our formula is Q3 minus Q1 divided by 2. Already we calculate Q1, now we calculate Q3. The formula for Q3 is equal to L plus 3N by 4 minus Cf upon F into H. But our first purpose is we have to locate the Q3 class or upper quartile class. So this class can be located by using the value 3N by 4. So 3N by 4 means 3 into 180 divided by 4, which is equals to 135. So we have to find that cumulative frequency which is just greater than 135. So 10 is less than 135, 30 is also less than 135, 60 is less than 135, 110 is less than 135, but 150 is the first value which is just greater than 135. So this 40 to 50, this class interval is our Q3 class. And lower limit of this Q3 class is equal to 50. Frequency of that class, means this is the value of F, frequency of that class is equals to 40. And cumulative frequency just preceding to that class, means this value. So this is the value of Cf. So Cf is equal to 110. Just substitute all these values in that formula and calculate the answer. So here L is equals to 40, lower limit of that class. 3N by 4 is equal to 135. Just substitute the value. Cf is 110. It is the cumulative frequency preceding to that class, that is 110, and frequency of that class is 40. Here frequency of that class is 40 into class width, that is upper class limit minus lower class limit, 50 minus 40, which is equals to 10. After doing all these calculation, the value of Q3 is equal to 46.25, and the answer is right, because 46.25 lies between this class interval, that is 40 to 50. Now we have to find the quartile deviation, and the formula for quartile deviation is Q3 minus Q1 divided by 2. And we just find out the value of Q3 and Q1. Just substitute that value here. Q3 is equal to 46.25 and Q1 is equal to 25. So 46.25 minus 25 is 21.25 divided by 2. So quartile deviation is equal to 10.625. Now the second question is also find the coefficient of quartile deviation, and the formula or definition of coefficient of quartile deviation is Q3 minus Q1 divided by Q3 plus Q1. Here Q3 is 46.25 and Q1 is 25. Just substitute this value and compute the answer. Therefore, the coefficient of quartile deviation is 0.2983. So, for this data, the value of quartile deviation is 10.625 and the value of coefficient of quartile deviation is 0.2983. Next topic is merits and demerits of quartile deviation. So first we'll see what are the merits of quartile deviation. First one is it is very easy to understand and easy to calculate. Next, it can be computed for a frequency distribution with open end classes. So for open end classes we can calculate the quartile deviation. Next one is it is not affected by the presence of extreme values, means there is no effect of the extreme values. Next one is demerits or a drawback of quartile deviation. So the first demerit is quartile deviation is not based on all the observations, since it ignores 25% of the data at the lower end and 25% data at the upper end of the distribution, because we just consider the formula is Q3 minus Q1. So we just consider the two quartiles, that is upper quartile and lower quartile. Means the 25% observation from the lower end and 25% observation from the upper ends are deleted. If we saw the diagrammatic representation of quartiles for the definition of quartile deviation, we use just this part and this part. So this middlemost part is deleted. So it is not based on the all the observation, and this is the drawback of quartile deviation. Next drawback is quartile deviation is affected considerably by sampling fluctuation. And last one is it is not suitable for further mathematical treatment. So these are the drawbacks of quartile deviation. So in today's lecture we saw what is range. So range is defined as L minus S, that is largest observation minus smallest observation. And then we saw the next measure of dispersion, that is quartile deviation, or it is also known as semi-interquartile range. And it is defined as quartile deviation is equal to Q3 minus Q1 divided by 2. The relative measure of dispersion of range is coefficient of range, and it is defined as L minus S upon L plus S. And the relative measure of dispersion of quartile deviation is coefficient of quartile deviation, and it is defined as coefficient of quartile deviation is equal to Q3 minus Q1 upon Q3 plus Q1. In next lecture, we will continue with our next topic. Thank you.